Thank you, thank you! You freed the lands between!
Oh, I wouldn't say freed. More like, under new management.
Hello everyone and welcome. Today I answer the question, can you beat Elden Ring as a wandering noble? I get asked to do a run with only the noble's slender sword or the noble's estoc basically every video I make, and I don't really know why. I mean, these weapons aren't the best, they probably aren't even the best within their own class, but they aren't like, bad or anything. I guess it's because people want to see me lose my mind farming for them, but joke's on you, I used to play WoW 14 hours a day, so a 0.5% drop rate is nothing. That being said, the place to farm it is a little rough, to say the least. Anyway, after about 15 minutes, the slender sword dropped, and I thought about calling it here, but according to the wiki, the nobles with the feather in their cap dropped the estoc, and there are far fewer of them, therefore, weapon more rare. I guess. So I decided to go for that instead. And about an hour later, I have become a part of the 1%, a true noble amongst the peasants of the lands between. Margit, I hear you have been fairly taxing the local riffraff, and for that, you must pay in blood.
I first tried him. I didn't even upgrade the weapon yet.
You know what? Just to assert dominance all over this castle and claim it for my own, I'm gonna do the same thing to Godric. I did it. There is no punchline here. I just wanted to trash Godric with a +0 weapon.
So obviously, yes, you can beat the game like this. There is no limiting factor such as mana or crazy requirements to get it, just a tarnished with a weapon. I'm sure some of you have already commented that, and that's fine. Honestly, you're just stating the obvious. But I hope you stick around because I'm sure there's at least one thing in this video you didn't see coming.
Then you can quickly edit your comment and I'll be none the wiser. And hey, while you're down there, maybe consider giving a like and subscribing to help the channel out?
Anyway, my first order of business as King of Castle Stormvale is to take over the neighboring land to the north. While it is completely possible to beat this game with an unleveled weapon, I don't like this thing's moveset enough to do that. So, I strategically cut off Liurnia's supply of smithing stones, or as I like to say, Operation Blue Murder. With that taken care of, my trusty estoc is brought to a +5, then I decide for the future of the land, no tarnish can be educated, so I take on the academy. First is this adorable guard dog, and right joke about Red Wolf here. Hey, what do you get when you cross the Red Wolf of Radagon with a noble's estoc? 14,000 runes. One lone defender. Ha! Like that'll stop me. Oh no. I have no idea why I thought Impaling Thrust wasn't parryable, but boy was I wrong. Fortunately, then the idiot put his shield away in favor of magic, and look where that got him. Queen Renala, might I say you look wonderful this evening. May I have this dance? The melody, you ask? One of my favorites. It's a symphony of destruction. This fight isn't hard, but phase 2 I did notice that my regular light attacks don't stagger in one hit, and that makes me a tiny bit anxious for a future fight, but that's a bridge I'll burn when I get to it. With her down, I can head back to Roundtable Hold for a third talisman slot, only to realize I haven't been using talismans this whole time. Nor have I been using the second half of my physic. There aren't really any overpowered things I can add to a single estoc, but I am leaving damage on the table, so I guess I'll pick up the Spear Talisman, the Blue Dancer Charm, the Strength and Dexterity tiers, and the Ritual Sword Talisman. To be honest, the Blue Dancer Charm probably isn't worth it. I'm already at the lowest damage increase possible, but for now there isn't much else to use. Anyway, hello, Tree Sentinel of the Draconic variety. It is I, the future ruler of this capital. If you won't let me pass, I will murder you. Draconic Tree Sentinel has been slain. Yes. Yes, he has, but since when does it say that? Oh, that's right, I'm running the seamless co-op mod. Not because I thought I need help, no, I'm a noble that can pull himself up by his own bootstraps, but because the base game only has 10 character slots, and that's frickin' stupid. I don't know why it's only 10 character slots or who thought that was enough, but it's absolutely not. Someone please make a mod that gives like 100 save slots, like that's all it has to do, just that, just increase the number, please. As a fair and just noble, I would never hurt an innocent citizen practicing their trumpet skills. What's that? He owes back taxes. Moving right along to Godfrey Midas Edition, are any of you surprised he is not a problem? I mean, I know I'm a broken record at this point, but he's such an easy and fair fight, in this case I'm using a normal weapon, so he just gets destroyed and a 4th talisman slot. Great, I only just figured out what to do with the first three. Okay, jump attacks would be helpful for a specific fight later, so I grab the Claw Talisman, and the Blue Dancer Charm kind of isn't pulling its weight anymore, so Winged Sword Insignia, I guess? Next up is Morgoth, who is so easy I could probably no-hit him. You just have to embarrass me in front of the nice people, don't you, game? I did learn here that the Estoc's poise damage is so low the old 2-charge attacks into a jumping strong isn't enough to break his guard, but another jump attack pushes him over the top. With him down, I am now the King of Lindell, and my first decree is to burn this big tree to the ground. Unfortunately, the only thing with enough firepower to do so lies in the far north. Before embarking on that adventure, however, I find a cave with a particularly interesting tarnished, Patches. I spare him his life, as my court advisors have informed me, Ruthless Warlord is not trending among young people, and I gotta get them votes. Anyway, I buy the local man's chicken feet and then head north to the mountaintops of the giants. There, I ask the friendly neighborhood fire giant if I could use his forge, but he refuses. Fortunately for me, the first thing they teach you in noble school is if your partner doesn't want to help you, slash their ankles. Y'all want to see why I hate this fight? I had no-hit the boss up until this point. Anyway, he goes down after a couple of tries and I can finally set my plan in motion. What? What do you mean that's not what the scientists meant by, we need to address global warming? Next up is the Godskin duo, and I'm so happy to see another noble. Finally, we can have a fair and just fight, as a true noble would never utilize underhanded tactics. I hate this game. I thought about using sleep pots for this fight, but I'm not sure if there are any wandering noble enemies that are associated with sleep, so instead I do the next best thing, which is just turn it into a one-on-one, and before long, the duo is no more. Up next is everyone's favorite Doggo Man, Dragon Lord Placidusax. I lied about the Doggo Man. So Placidusax here has a weakness to pierce damage, but with how little damage I'm doing, you could have fooled me. But I knew he would be an easy set of runes, and also, as a noble, it is my duty to fight anything with the title Lord. Okay, now it's time for Malekith. Phase 1 is, it's definitely there. Phase 2, I was curious to know if my very thin sword would struggle to hit him, like how daggers or fist weapons do, but thankfully that wasn't the case. I even managed to get a stagger right at the end, but like, what good does that really do? Hey Gideon, what did the noble lord say to the pompous tarnished? Knife to meet you. That joke would have made a lot more sense in the dagger only video. And here we have a visual representation of what it's like to fight me in PvP. Ah, Godfrey, still one of my favorite fights in all of Soulsborne. No underhanded techniques or blisteringly fast combos, just a big old ungabunga axe and a dream. I almost no-hit phase 1, right up until I went all in thinking I'd do enough damage to push the phase, and then I didn't. I will admit, I don't like Horlu as much. It still feels like a fair fight, but I think my problem is I don't have to engage with him as much. The normal game plan is to just roll away from his lunging grabs and get a couple hits in. Anyway, the Elden Chad goes down on the first try, and now it's time for Radagon of the Golden Order. I'm sure it's no surprise to anyone, but this fight is completely normal. Nothing of note happened. The man took many sword stabs to the chest and eventually goes down. There were some weird moments with Elden Beast, however, mostly him just doing attacks at points that didn't make a whole lot of sense. Like, what is this? He was going for a forward swipe, but I'm mostly behind him. I don't know. Doesn't really matter, because after just a few minutes, he goes down and I am now the supreme ruler of the lands between. My first order of business is to seek out the reclusive commander far to the north, because I heard that when the sun hits Castle Soul just right, those hills sing. Not the beautiful song I had in mind, but it'll work. Niall isn't a problem, and a few impaling thrusts straight to the dick later, he goes down. Me too, bro. Me too. Some of you may have noticed, but I've been stacking vigor for a specific fight later on, so I decided to tackle Moog next for some easy runes. It was at this point, however, that I realized I never actually picked up the purifying crystal tier. Well, that's embarrassing. I'm actually kind of impressed with how low I got his health before he phase transitioned. I mean, I doubt I could have one-cycled him, but for not using any buff, that seems pretty good. Either way, he's so easy, I actually took no damage during the fight, and he so graciously gifted me nearly 550,000 runes as well as rule over his land. So, my first order of business is to head to Melania to tell her of her lost twin. I'm sure she'll be happy and listen to every word I have to say. Through Ordina and down the Hallig Tree, I fight Loretta. I'll be honest, I was trying to think of something funny or interesting here, but Loretta is a pushover if you have any kind of normal weapon, so I'll just skip ahead to the title fight of this area. Unfortunately, a single standard light attack isn't enough to stagger Melania, but that's less a problem and more of an inconvenience because I usually do jumping attacks anyway to punish the end of her combos. At the end of her first phase, I actually anti-aired her, which was cool, I guess. I mean, I've never done it before. Phase 2, I noticed a bit of a problem. One of the easiest ways to get damage on her is to dodge through the plunging explosion combo finisher and just charge a heavy swing, but I kept whiffing that attack. Obviously this is doable, but for some reason my positioning was off. Before I could adapt, however, she exploited my one true weakness. Five angry phantom ladies rushing me down. Every noble's desire, really. But in the end, I thrust directly into her and she goes down. Radahn, I have come to inform you that the Rot Goddess is no more. Guys, where's Radahn? Honestly, if this weapon did more poise damage, I probably could have downed him without even going to phase 2, but I wasn't able to get a stagger off. Not like it mattered, he started with the meteor summon and, didn't end well for him. Next, I decided to visit the princess in the tower to the northwest, but first, Ghost Etta. Honestly, I was kind of hoping she wouldn't spawn here because I already fought the real version, but I mean, I am vastly out-leveled for this area. I feel like a 7-foot-tall professional basketball player 1v1ing a second grader.
Hey, Ronnie, so listen, I know I beat up your mom, and killed your dad, and your brother, but how you doing?
Moon Princess was surprisingly chill about the fact I assaulted her whole family and said if I wanted to unite our royal powers, I just have to get her a funny pointy stick that I'm sure she won't use to exact revenge on me. So, down in Anachron, I face off against my equal and quickly prove that we share one brain cell.
Bambi, the usual today.
I really do want this fight to be more than it is. Every time I walk through that fog wall, I wonder if this weapon will be the one to do it. For the estoc, I had hoped Regal Ancestor Spear's height combined with how thin the sword is would make him hard to hit, but no, it didn't.
Hey, Ronnie, I'm back with that dagger you requested. You're still not mad about the whole family murder thing, right? Oh good, I'm glad. What's that? You want me to turn my back to you and point to where my heart is? Okay, I trust you.
Nothing happened because Ronnie wouldn't hurt a fly.
Next up is Estelle, who's absolutely not an issue, but I will say he did one of the dumbest things I've ever seen a boss do. He teleported away from me, and by away, I mean closer to me. I don't know if he has predetermined locations for where he can teleport for the meteors or not, but I was not expecting him to pick one right next to me. Either way, I just start attacking his foot and he goes down first try. My reign of power now extends all over the upper world, but what about the subterranean world? Normally, since I already fought regular Moog, I wouldn't do sewer Moog, but to be honest, I just enjoy stabbing this guy in the face. He deserves it. Well, that and I knew I would need something from the sewers later, so it just made more sense. Anyway, both versions of Moog have a weakness to pierce damage. Well, sort of. They actually just don't resist any of the physical damage types very well, probably because he's just wearing a normal fire-resistant robe and not his anti-sword robes, but that's his fault, and like 80 seconds later, he goes down. Fia's Champions, my favorite. I will give credit where credit is due. The first one has a small shield, and after my run-in with Moongrum, I'm wary of doing anything remotely parryable. But then I broke his stance and did almost his entire life bar with one repose, so that fear's gone. The rest of the champions aren't a problem either, just lots of jumping attacks and impaling thrusts. Hey, Fia.
What's that? I need to go look for the Hollowbrand?
Joke's on you, I already did that, so start dreaming, lady, I have a dragon to slay. Just like the stories the villagers used to tell, a noble warrior fighting against a fierce fire-breathing dragon. I don't remember the lightning or clouds of literal death, but I'm sure that will make for a more riveting tale. The battle raged on for a grueling 2 whole minutes before finally the mighty beast was slain, and now only one remains, Rykard, Lord of Blasphemy. So, my first attempt went surprisingly well, actually. I managed to get him fairly low into phase 2 before dying to something stupid. Honestly, if I hadn't made the mistake of walking into his sword, I'm sure I would have lived. Which coincidentally was probably the motto of every knight in the medieval times, but I digress. Unfortunately, I was paying attention, and part of that success came from Rykard being so dumbfounded by the fact I was stabbing him with a tiny sword that his AI broke and he just didn't attack much during phase 1. In other words, this is possible, but I need to get lucky if I wanted to beat him as is. Of course, I could pick up the Serpent Hunter Spear and call it a day, after all, he is a gimmick boss, but I have a better idea. First, I farm not one, but 2 more estocs, then get the Kindreds of Rot and Lords of Blood Exaltation Talismans, pick up the Glintstone and Black Wet Blades, buy Impaling Thrust, duplicate it with some Lost Ashes of War, grab the Bull Goat Talisman, which in hindsight was completely useless, then finally make a plus 25 Blood, Frost, and Poison estoc. I am now the Apex Noble. So the plan is to poison him, then just proc Bleed and Frostbite as much as I could. I thought about also making a fire estoc to reset the frost, but I didn't know if that would actually work, and honestly, I just didn't want to farm for another one of those damn things. Anyway, because of the lava pool, I could only get 3 attacks in before being staggered, and because of how Power Stance Thrusting Swords work, that basically means 1 left-handed attack and 2 right-handed ones. So, I put the poison and frost estoc in the left hand and blood in the right to maximize the procs. And just like that, the big Serpent King falls, and the challenge has ended. Thank you everyone for watching, and an extra special thanks to my patrons, stay beautiful y'all. If you enjoyed the video, please consider giving a like and subscribing, it helps the channel out way more than you know, but until next time my friends, don't you dare go hollow.